that since they went to war and we had no support for the military whatsoever, which we haven't. Now, remember, we haven't had support for our military since 1940s. Our war in Korea was a disaster. The Vietnam War was a disaster. The Iraq Wars were a disaster. Afghanistan, Yemen, Somalia, Pakistan. So what does the military say? Forget it. We'll just go to anywhere we want. We'll create wars, even with, you know, the president, who may not be CIA, but he is. And we'll just create drone attacks. And most people don't care.
That's right.
And most people aren't relevant. So what I'm saying is, yeah, we have a major disintegration of our institutions that is primarily represented by the military, the intelligence community, which constitutes a major part of our budget, because we're in 732 bases in 234 countries. We don't have that many terrorists.
Yeah.
So we really have begun to start to disintegrate internally and externally. But we need, it's a moment of hope. Actually, the guys like you, the alternative media, has really preempted modern day media or the mainstay media, where you have guys like Anderson Cooper, who we can talk about, who was really, you know, an intern at the CIA a couple of years in a row.
Mm-hmm,
but he's
mm-hmm.
CIA. That's why he was fed this. This is not conspiracy. I mean, I've been in the business. I oversaw the CIA. I oversaw National Reconnaissance Organization. I oversaw all of them without belonging to them, but being their bosses, so to speak, because they had to report to a deputy assistant secretary of state. What that means is, we are the ones who implement policy. We're the ones who create the initiatives that go overseas. In my particular case, I just dismissed the CIA for 30 years because they were incompetent. The only time they were competent was when Jimmy Carter fired over 4,000 CIA operatives. He was the first man only, and he was military.
Mm-hmm.
So not only did we have an inherent tension between the military and the civilians, but we've had this ongoing war where they're becoming less and less reliable. And that's why the agencies have become more reliable, and they're drawing away our monies.
Let me ask you about the Snowden leaks. Now, he's been accused by the U.S. of being a Russian spy, a Chinese spy. I don't think too many people buy that line, but there are people who question whether this is a limited hangout or if he's a genuine whistleblower. You have a different take on this. Tell us what your take is on the Ed Snowden documents.
Yeah, sure. You want me to tell you?
Go ahead.
Well, basically, let me go back to the history of Putin and Russia. Having been mainly involved in the takedown of the Soviet Union, I was sent to the RAND Corporation specifically to develop the architecture for the psychological warfare of taking down the Soviet Union. It wasn't done by the CIA. It wasn't done by Mikhail Gorbachev. I'm not the only one, but I was one of the few who could delineate the architecture because I was trained in both political science and in psychiatry, and I'd worked in the Soviet Union over 10 years during the 70s under Nixon and Ford and Reagan, take out political dissidents in psychiatric hospitals. So I had a very good idea where the weaknesses were. And I knew the KGB very well and the GRU. So when we took down the Soviet Union, we in fact made a mistake. We gave it to Yeltsin. Yeltsin was misread. I must admit, I may have been part of that. I don't remember Yeltsin as well as I should have, but he ended up to be a drunk. But I do remember we reconstituted our attempts and put in Gorbachev. And Gorbachev, I thought, that's the one we were working with very strongly. We first had Gorbachev where we took down. And then Yeltsin came in. I'm sorry. We worked against Gorbachev. Then Yeltsin came in, and Yeltsin turned out to be an alcoholic. And I was no longer in the government, but I had some input to say, look, this is not good. Russia has to reconstitute itself. We cannot have a sense of chaos in 122 different federations, which is really what Russia was. And instead, we had a guy named Putin. Didn't come up because he was a good guy, a bad guy. He's put up because the intelligence community, on a positive sense, brought in a guy who was very strong, who was trained by Marcus Wolf and by Andropov, guys that I worked with and knew.
So you're talking about Putin being put in. Would you say that the intelligence community in the U.S. had something to do with that?
I would say very strongly that they had. I think it was a very positive move. The intelligence community was very much a part, collectively, along with my initiatives at the RAND Corporation, others who were specialists in the Soviet Union, from the CIA and military intelligence, had the ability to take down the Soviet Union systematically without any war. And I think that's something that both Reagan and Bush Sr. in particular, and Baker, should be very proud of, and the Americans should be proud of, because this was an example where we had regime change without the use of military forces, without the fact that I know Charlie Wilson's war was emphasized as the pièce de résistance for the CIA, but the takedown of the Soviet Union was far more sophisticated. It involved national character. It involved economics. It involved the use and manipulation of the KGB and many other variables, which was not relevant to war, but to financial areas. In turn, what happened is when you bring down a regime, it takes some time, but at the same time, you have to think of what will follow the takedown of the regime. What you don't want is a power vacuum. In that power vacuum, you don't want a totalitarian leader to evolve. Having said that, what happened was the KGB entities became oligarchs and, in fact, became corrupt oligarchs. So every one of the institutions or factories in the United States that was run through the Central Committee became fractionated, hybridized, and cannibalized by the KGB. They took it over, and, in fact, there was no central control. Gorbachev, it turned out, the minute we put him in and we thought he was capable of handling a very, very multivariate country with many different elements and ethnic groups. And remember, the Soviet Union was consisted of 122 different countries and ethnicities. Gorbachev had failed. Then Yeltsin came in. I had left by that time, but I was still involved in the issue of, well, what will and who will manage the Soviet Union and Russia. The Russian Federation, in and of itself, is 11 time zones, so it's pretty big. Yeltsin turned out to be an alcoholic. Whether that was a misreading on behalf of our intelligence community or not, it was one of those elements that came out and had to be rectified very quickly. Within the ranks of the intelligence community in the Soviet Union or in Russia was a young man, ironically, trained first in East Germany. And who was he trained by? He was trained by someone who I had known and had encountered through a proxy, a man by the name of Marcus Wolf. Many of your listeners will know Marcus Wolf by the key player in the movie The Spy Who Came In from the Cold by Jean-Luc Godard. Mm-hmm. Marcus Wolf was a very special spy master, perhaps the greatest spy master of all, who ran over 100,000 East German Stasi operatives, S-T-A-S-S-I, operatives all over East Germany and the world. He had penetrated the BND, or the West German intelligence, and some of our own intelligence. He was so brilliant that by the time we were able to amalgamate or integrate East Germany with West Germany, we could not arrest Marcus Wolf because it would serve no purpose. Instead, he allowed his family to flee overseas, and we allowed him to become a cook. In that process, a very young man who worked for the East German intelligence eventually transitioned into the FSB or the KGB, and his name was Putin, Vladimir Putin. So he was identified very early on in our intelligence community as someone who was very pure Russian meaning not from Moscow, but from Leningrad, and whose grandfather, by the way, was a cook, not only for Tsar Alexander, but also for Stalin, and was very well entrenched in what we call the nationalist character of Russia. So he was trained not only by Marcus Wolf of East Germany, but by someone I had to work against, Andropov, the KGB, who was also a brilliant spy master. So eventually, it was understood in the intelligence community that Putin would have to be the reigning ruler of the new Russian Federation, which we had taken down through the Soviet system, and he would have to accrue power by becoming totalitarian and really Russian in nature. And he was true to form. He basically consolidated the power. He consolidated all the oligarchs. He made sure that the oligarchs were in no way involved in political chicanery in Moscow. And in turn, they all received billions of dollars of corrupt political cronyism types of businesses, Gazprom, as well as construction companies, as well as all types of different industries that they were not attuned to or they were capable of running, but instead that was their political payoff on one condition, that these oligarchs never get involved in politics with Putin. Putin was true to form. And I think the success of the Sochi Olympics is the ultimate point of showing how a totalitarian leader, using his skills, using his background, is able to consolidate a huge country like Russia into a spectacular phenomenon in the midst of a terrorist scenario. So Putin has to be given credit, but at the same time, he arose because of the needs and concerns of the American and European intelligence branches. As a result, Putin really worked with, in collaboration with the CIA and our military intelligence, to allow us to transit through Russia into Afghanistan. And we paid him a lot of money to transit into Afghanistan. And that money, in turn, he allowed us to be able to put over spies or alleged spies like Snowden.
Let me ask you this, Dr. Pechenik. If it's in the U.S.'s interest to have one person to deal with in that area, to have a consolidated Russia, and Putin was the guy that they identified as doing that, give me your take on what's going on now in the Ukraine, where it appears that the EU and the U.S. are trying to undermine Putin. Is that your take on this, or?
Well, Ukraine has always had a history of what I call divided loyalties. Western Ukraine has always been part and parcel of Poland. After World War I, and historically, the Ukraine was never really part of its own national character. It had a certain cultural determinant, but never a geographical determinant. After World War I, Western Ukraine was part of Poland. It fought Poland and wanted to be part of Eastern Ukraine, which was also part of Russia. So you have the Eastern Ukraine, which is Russian, and the Western Ukraine. But the real issue in the Ukraine right now is not democracy versus the EU, or Russia versus the United States. What it really is the Ukraine has no more money. And because of the corruption that occurred, and because of our failure in the Orange Revolution about 10 years ago, and I don't fault us for that, it just turned out not to be as successful as we thought it was, meaning that we were able to bring a liberal democracy in there, but in turn, Putin was able to reverse it. The real issue at hand is about $15 billion worth of debt that has to be serviced, and that the EU is not willing to put up, neither is America, and that Putin said to the Ukrainian president, Yanukovych, look, I will collect all your debts, but in turn, I will give you cheaper oil, but you must maintain the integrity of my oil pipelines into Europe. That's the real issue at hand. What happened with Assistant Secretary Nuland, this woman who said, Akfe Yufe to Europe, was nothing more than a very childish, impish attempt on an open phone to show the world that America was involved in really having strategy and in being involved in an aggressive anti-Russian campaign. The reality is quite different. We're not very effective.
Your opinion, her statement made on an open phone was really sending a message to the world.
It was sending a message, but it was childish. It was inappropriate, and it was not consistent with our ability to maintain a diplomatic presence and at the same time manipulate the parties involved. She is not, I believe, Korea Foreign Service, although she states she's Korean Foreign Service. But her background, her actions belie that, and it seems to me that she may belong to another part of our government. I don't want to announce which part, but she had been Vice President Cheney's chief of staff, along with many other neocons, and her husband, Mr. Kagan, is a famous neocon. So I think she went off on her own as the Assistant Secretary for Europe and really belied any sense of strategy and tactics. You do not allow yourself to be compromised that way or even send a signal that way. It's gauche. It's childish, and the Russians will handle you with counterforce. So I felt that it was totally inappropriate. I think John Kerry, if he's an effective Secretary of State, and I'm not sure he is, he should dismiss her and fire her. But that's my personal opinion and profession.
I thought it was pretty amazing, the reaction from the White House chief spokesman, Jay Carney, says it's something about Russia. It says something about Russia that they would tap a telephone call. I mean, the insanity of that. It's like you can hear the entire world laughing that they would make a statement like that. We'll have the conclusion of that interview tomorrow night on the InfoWars Nightly News. It's a perspective from someone who's spent decades in the intelligence community. Don't miss it. Join us at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.